Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My dear students, Assalamu alaikum. I am Dr. Atika Masood, and today we are going to do the most important topic of neoplasia chapter, and that is the clinical manifestations of the neoplasia. My dear students, it's very, very essential to remember that what are the clinical manifestations or the clinical features of the neoplasia in order to identify them timely, so you will be able to diagnose them and you will be able to treat them. Otherwise, if you don't know the clinical features, signs and symptoms with which neoplasia patient is going to be presented to you people in the clinical setting, then it is going to metastasize, then this neoplasia is going to metastasize and the patient will be untreatable at that stage. So, for today, we are going to discuss the most important warning signs of the cancers or the clinical features, and we will discuss about the whether there is a cachexia or the unexplained weight loss, is there a shortness of breath going on, there is a weakness or the fatigue that is going to happen, is there any frequent infections that is going to happen, and related with the other carcinomas, specifically to their sites. If it is involving the gut, then it is going to involve and it is going to present with the bowel problems. If it is having a relationship with the stomach, then it can present with the chronic heartburns. And if it has have a problem with the GI tract, then it can present with the bloating or gas-like symptom. That mainly many of the patients are going to tell you that we are presenting with the bloating symptoms. And if it is a lung carcinoma and the patient has a chronic cough and chest pain, we are going to talk about it and we are going to see that how these patients are going to present. So anything, any change, whether this change is in the nails, whether change there is a change in your bowel patterns, whether there is a change in the swallowing, or there is a simple weight loss, you have to be very conscious and you have to see that what is the underneath thing that is going on. So the learning objectives of today's lecture will be that at the end of the lecture, the students will be enabled to enlist the clinical manifestations of the neoplasm. They will be able to give the pathogenesis of the cachexia that is being related with the neoplastic activities, and you will be able to enumerate paraneoplastic syndromes along with the associated tumors. My dear students, this question of the paraneoplastic syndromes often comes in your university exam, and this is very, very important. So we are going to start with the cancer cachexia. So basically, what do we mean by cachexia? Anything that is going to be referred for the terminal stages of the advanced cancer, in which we are going to have a progressive loss of the body fat and the lean body mass. And my dear students, just remember this thing. Basically, there is a loss of the muscle mass. So the important thing is the skeletal muscle wasting or the loss of the muscle mass. And because of this, the patient is going to present with a profound weakness, anorexia, nervosa, anemia. So patient is having anemia because of, we are going to see that this anemia is because of the ulcerations, this anemia is because of the hemorrhage in the tumors, and the blood loss in cases of stomach cancers, in cases of GI bleed, in cases of liver carcinomas or hepatocellular carcinomas, repeated or intercurrent infections because of the decreased immunity. This patient is going to come with the repeated infections. So in the cancer cachexia, basically we are going to deal with the unintentional weight loss, and patient is going to come and is going to tell you that I have lost 10 to 20 kg of weight in just 6 to 8 months, and I'm not on the diet, or the patient is going to tell you that my clothes are being very, very unfitted, and I'm not on the exercise, and I'm not on special quick on keto diet or other thing like that. And patient is also going to tell you that I am not that there is a loss of appetite, or the anorexia is also going on. So as far as cancer cachexia is related, the main problem is that there is the secretion of the tumor necrosis factor alpha and the interleukin 1 from the activated macrophages, and this interleukin 1 and the tumor necrosis factor alpha are going to play an important role in the development of the cancer cachexia, and they are also going to cause the acute systemic phase responses also in the body. TNF-alpha is going to suppress the appetite that I've just told you about, that there is a suppression of the appetite, and this is going to be accomplished by inhibiting the lipoprotein lipases. So the appetite center will be suppressed. There will be another thing, and that is the increase in the caloric expenditure. And this caloric expenditure, because of the increase in amount, there is a loss of body fat, and also there is a loss of the muscle mass also going on. I have just told you about anemia, that patient is going to be anemic. So because of the anemia, he is also feeling lethargic. And because of this anemia is basically, it could be bleeding from the ulcerative lesions, in which area it is going to be involved. And as you know, my dear students, when the tumor is growing and there is a rapid vasculogenesis or angiogenesis, and lot of blood vessels are coming there, and as you know that these are all new blood vessels, new sprouting, then the bleeding can occur due to the expansile growth of the tumor. So because of this bleeding, and the patient could present to you with the anemia. Then the patient could present to you with anorexia, and there is a causes of the anorexia could be because of the abnormalities in the taste, and I have just told you that there will be the central inhibition by the TNF-alpha. Then there are the intercurrent infections, as there will be the impaired immune defenses. We are going to discuss later on in our lectures that the immune system is not going to identify the tumors. There are the dysregulations in the immune system because of the cancer development, and because of this there will be the repeated infections, and patient is going to come to you with the fever or light grade fever, and these symptoms are going to occur again and again. So because of this, your patient is going to experience weight loss. The patient is having bloating or pain in the abdomen, severe headache. There could be, if the tumor is in the eyes areas or in the brain area, which is suppressing the optic nerves, then it can also come with the optic problems. There could be the fractures related with that, and there could be dizziness related with that. So the patient can come to you with a lot of symptoms, and you have to see that what is the cause of these symptoms. So we are going to discuss about the ulcerations on the tumor surface. First of all, when there is a neoplasm in a GI tract, my dear student, because of the peristaltic pull of the gravitational pull, there will be the ulceration of the mucosa because of the intussusception. And because of the intussusception, there will be the secondary changes that are going to happen. And these secondary changes include secondary bleedings. And because of the bleeding, there could be infection because it is an expansile growth, and in the gut we have lots of bacteria, so infections could occur. And because of the intussusception, there could be intestinal obstruction, and as this intussusception is going to block the major vessels which are supplying the gut, so there could be the gut infarction. So there are few symptoms that are because of the location of the tumor. My dear students, just remember this thing. Sometimes the tumor is very, very benign in nature. I'm going to give you an example like meningioma. I'm giving you an example of a very senior colleague who is also a gynecologist, and she was presenting again and again with the unconsciousness and headache. When the they have searched for the underneath the, what is underneath this symptoms, they have found out that it is basically compressing the brain, and because of the compression of the brain, this benign tumor is also going to create some symptoms. So whether the tumor is benign or the tumor is malignant, the location of the tumor is very, very important. And we are going to see the other examples like pituitary adenoma. Here you can see that there is a pituitary adenoma. I hope you can see this. There is a pituitary adenoma, and this pituitary adenoma is very, very small, less than 1 centimeter in size. It is going to compress the surrounding normal gland, and because of the suppression of the normal gland, there will be the destruction of the normal parenchyma, and it is going to result into the hypopituitarism. And if it is this pituitary adenoma is compressing the optic nerve, if it is compressing the optic nerve, then it is also causing the blindness and sometimes blurring of the vision. So as you know, adenoma is a very, very benign thing, but the symptoms that it is going to cause are very, very troublesome. Then comes an other benign tumor like a leiomyoma. As you all remember that leiomyoma is a smooth muscle tumor, and if this smooth muscle tumor, benign tumor, is present in the renal artery, so you can imagine what it is going to cause. It is going to block the renal artery, and because of blocking the renal artery, it is going to cause the back pressure. And because of the back pressure, there will be the hypertension due to the activation of the renin angiotensin system and the development of the renal ischemia. So, my dear students, you can see here, there is a very, very small carcinoma in the common bile duct. And this is also called as cholangiocarcinoma. And this is going to cause the biliary tract obstruction and the jaundice. So, the other feature that the neoplasms are going to present is an acute emergency. Sometimes they are going to present with the infarctions and sometimes with the rupture. And we are going to see that in acute emergencies, the patient are going to present to you with the acute abdomen. Here are the few examples, like the cystic teratoma of the mobile ovary. Because the ovary is mobile, and there is, you can see, a cystic teratoma. Here you can see this is a very, very benign tumor. In the cystic teratoma, you can see the teeth-like structure. You can see hair-like structure. You have glandular or sebaceous items in this. So this teratoma, because it is in the mobile ovary, when it is going to twist and it is going to cause the infarction, the patient is going to come with a severe abdominal pain or the signs of the acute abdomen. So again, a benign tumor, but it is going to create the emergency because of the infarction. Then we are having a very, very lethal type of tumor, that is hepatocellular carcinoma. The tumor of the liver, because it is very, very angiogenic in nature, all the hepatocellular carcinomas are very, very highly vascularized because of the dual blood supply system also. So if there is any rupture in the tumor of the liver, there will be the massive intraperitoneal bleed, and patient can present to you with the shock. So circulatory shock will be there in these patients. Then we are going to deal with the manifestations of the endocrine neoplasm. These are those neoplasms in which the endocrine glands are involved. And because of the involvement of the endocrine gland, these endocrine gland secretions will be higher in number. And because of their increase in number, there will be the clinical manifestation. The examples of these endocrine neoplasms, as you can see, adenoma or carcinoma of the beta cells of the islets of pancreas is going to cause the hyperinsulinism. This hyperinsulinism is just like type 2 diabetes, but it is not a diabetes. Basically, there will be the overweight. Also, patients will present to you with the overweight, and there will be the increased secretion of the insulin. Then the second example is the adenoma or carcinoma of the adrenal cortex. If there is an adenoma or carcinoma of the adrenal cortex, as adrenal cortex is going to secrete the aldosterone, and you know that the basic function of the aldosterone is the sodium retention. So because of the sodium retention, sodium is also going to retain the water, and because of this there will be the hypertension and the hypokalemia. Hypokalemia is further going to aggravate the cardiac signs and symptoms also. Now we are going to discuss the most important thing, and that are the paraneoplastic syndrome. My dear students, just remember this thing. Whenever you are being asked about the paraneoplastic syndrome, these symptom complexes cannot be explained either by the local or the distant spread of the tumor, and they are not going to be explained by the elaboration of the hormones that are indigenous to the tissue of the origin of the tumor. I'm going to simplify for you people. Like, we are going to experience carcinoid syndrome, and this carcinoid syndrome can be seen in the patients of the lung carcinoma. But what it is happening in the lung that is going to cause the carcinoid syndrome? ACTH is not normally secreted in the lungs. So here is your example that these hormones are not indigenous to the tissue of the origin. So, and there is no, we are not talking about any distant spread of the tumor. Tumor is in the lungs, but it is going to create the carcinoid syndrome or Cushing syndrome. And because of this ACTH secretion, we are having the Cushing-like Cushingoid phases. We are having the serotonin, bradykinin releases in this, and this is going to cause the carcinoid syndrome or the Cushing syndrome in some cases. And we are going to see the examples of these. The most common ones are the endocrinopathies, and in endocrinopathies, we are having the, I have just told you about the Cushing syndrome, hypercalcemia, carcinoid syndrome. Basically, my dear student, just remember this thing. This Cushing syndrome is because of the increased secretion of the ACTH. And we are going to just see that what is going to happen in the patient and how this patient is going to present to you people. So, if we are going to talk about hypercalcemia, there will be release of the parathormone-like substances, and there will be the increase in the calcium. In carcinoid syndrome, there is basically the increase in the serotonin levels, and the patient is going to present with the flushings and the GI manifestations. Then comes acanthosis nigricans. And there you can see the patients of the acanthosis nigricans. There is a blackish pigmentation in the skin, and especially in the axillary regions and underneath the breast and in the neck region. Then we are having the hypertrophic osteopathy and the nail changes. So these osteoarthropathy can be seen in the hands or in the feet also. Then the most important one are the thrombotic diathesis, and wherever there is an involvement of the thrombotic diathesis, these patients can present with the disseminated intravascular clotting, DICs, and the non-thrombotic endocarditis, and both of them are very, very lethal in nature. So, my dear students, just remember this thing. that these paraneoplastic syndromes could be of endocrinopathies. These could be related with the skin, like we have just told you. These could be related with the joints. These could be related with your blood and the clotting profiles. Now, here is a picture of a Cushing syndrome that we have just talked about. You have seen many people who are taking the steroids and their faces are giving you a picture of the Cushingoid face. Like they have a red and very, very bulky like cheeks, and their face is going to be called as moon face. Sometimes there will be the increased susceptibility to infections because of the increased use of the steroids or the ACTH. In males, they are going to present you with the gynecomastia, and there will be the thin extremities. So the most important thing that we have just done is the flat round moon face, you can see here, and the gynecomastia. And then the most important thing is the neck region, where there is a buffalo hump in the neck. There is a buffalo hump, and this is a very, very important thing that you can easily see in females. The females can present with the amenorrhea and the hirsutism, and this, there will be the bruises and the petechiae, because the skin will be very, very thin, and there will be the ruptures of the vessels within this thin skin, and then there will be the increased risk of the fractures because of the osteoporosis. So this Cushing syndrome is very, very alarming in nature, and you have to see whether this ACTH is originally increased in number or it is secreting from some other site or from some carcinoma or the neoplasm which is going on. Then comes your carcinoid syndrome. Here you can see the patient have a flushing, and often this flushing is without the sweating. So here you can see the flushing on the cheeks of this patient. The patient have difficulty in breathing, and sometimes it's also wheezing. There is irregular heartbeat and diarrhea like symptoms are also, and abdominal comforts and cramps. Patient can present with all these GI manifestations, and if it is going to involve the heart, then there will be the irregular heartbeats also, and there will be the swellings of the ankle joints and the hand joints. So this is the carcinoid syndrome. So we are going to discuss one by one each of these paraneoplastic syndromes and their cancers and the substance that they are going to secrete from these carcinomas, which are going to cause these endocrinopathies. So my dear student, we have just seen the patients of the Cushing syndrome who has a moon face and a buffalo hump, and this is because of the secretion of the ACTH or ACTH like substance, because this is not the actual place, because, and this is going to be secreted from small cell carcinoma of the lungs, pancreatic carcinomas, or the neural tumors. So as you all know that ACTH is not the original site where from where it is going to be secreted. So these carcinomas are going to secrete ACTH like substance, and these are going to cause the Cushing syndrome. Then the most important one, second most important one, is the syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone, SAIDH. And this is because of the antidiuretic hormone or atrial natriuretic factor. And this is going to be secreted from small cell carcinoma of the lungs, and also from the intracranial neoplasm. Then comes hypercalcemia. I have already told you about the hypercalcemia, that in hypercalcemia, there is a basically release of the parathormone-like related proteins, and also interleukin-1 and the TGF. And this, the major causes of this hypercalcemia in the paraneoplastic syndromes are from the squamous cell carcinoma of the lungs, breast carcinoma, renal carcinoma, and adult T-cell leukemias or the lymphomas. Then comes the fourth main manifestation, which mainly many neoplastic plasms are going to present to you people, is the hypoglycemia. And this hypoglycemia is basically because of the secretion of insulin and insulin-like substance. And as I've already told you, that Insulin is never secreted from the ovaries. But in this condition, insulin is going to be secreted from the ovarian carcinomas, fibrosarcomas, or the other mesenchymal sarcomas. So this is not the pituitary, but it is going to secrete the insulin-like substances, and the result will be hypoglycemia. Here you can see the picture of the syndrome of the inappropriate antidiuretic hormones. Basically, there is a small cell carcinoma of the lung, and it is going to secrete the ADH. Because of this ADH, it is going to act on the kidney, and there will be the water retention. And because of the water retention, the message is going to go into the pituitary gland, and there is a further release of the ADH hormone, and so there will be this retention, hypertension, retention of sodium and the water, and the resultant will be the hypertension and the hypokalemia. So this is the whole circle. So normally ADH is secreted from the kidney and from the pituitary in the hypothalamic region. So it is normal, very much normal, but there is another focus in the lung that is secreting this ADH like substances or ADH, and this is going to cause the syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. Then comes your carcinoid syndrome. I've just shown you the picture of the carcinoid syndrome, in which the patient was flushing, and this is because of the release of serotonin, bradykinin, and this is basically secreted from the neoplasm, which are going to be affected in this case are the hepatocellular carcinomas, bronchial carcinomas, and the pancreatic carcinomas. Now comes the polycythemia, which is the six major manifestations or the endocrinopathies. As you all know, polycythemia means increase in the red cell count, and this is going to be achieved from the erythropoietin. As you all remember, my dear student, this erythropoietin is normally secreted from the kidney, but in this condition, in the paraneoplastic syndrome, it is going to be secreted from the gastric carcinoma, from the renal carcinoma, from the cerebral hemangioma, or from the hepatocellular carcinoma. We have just done the endocrinopathies, in which there is some hormone which is going to be secreted. We have seen the secretions of the ACTH, serotonin, bradykinin, erythropoietin, insulin-like growth factors, and other things, and insulin-like things. And now we are going to discuss the things which are going to be involved, and these are regarding the nerve and muscle syndrome. The most common manifestation in the neoplasm is the myasthenia, and basically myasthenia is because of some immunological reaction or the cross reactions which is going to happen in the bronchogenic carcinomas. Then comes your disorders of the central and the peripheral nervous system, and these are commonly seen in the patients of the breast carcinomas. Then comes our dermatological disorders that are also going to be seen in the paraneoplastic syndromes. I have just shown you the pictures of the acanthosis nigricans, and this is because of the secretion of the epidermal growth factors, and this is seen in the gastric, lung, and uterine carcinoma. Then come dermatomyositis. So in the dermatomyositis, my dear students, there will be the release of this immunological reactions are going to happen within the skin, and because of this there are the inflammatory response, and because of this the main cause is the bronchogenic or the breast carcinoma. Then there could be osseous or the articular or soft tissue changes, as I have just told you about the hypertrophic osteopathy or the clubbing of the fingers. As you all remember, this clubbing of the finger is very, very important in the bronchogenic carcinoma, but we do not know why it is happening and why there is a clubbing and why there are the osteoarthropathy is going to happen. Then We have just done with the venous thrombosis, and I have told you that this venous thrombosis is because of the tumor product, and this is seen in the pancreatic carcinoma, bronchogenic carcinoma, while non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis is because of the hypercoagulability, and it is seen in the advanced cancer. Along with the non-thrombotic bacterial endocarditis, we can also see the DIC. Then there is a red cell aplasia, and this is basically seen in the thymic neoplasm. And other conditions that are also going to be seen as the nephrotic syndrome. My dear students, what is the nephrotic syndrome? Basically, if your kidney is going to secrete more than 3 grams of the proteins per day, then it is going to be called as nephrotic syndrome. And it is because of some immune complexes injury that are going to damage your nephrons, and these are going to happen in lots of cancer. So this is the whole category of the paraneoplastic syndrome. And please do remember, if you are going to see that your patient is presenting with the bleeding or with the infections or with the swelling of the lymph nodes all over the body or in the armpits or in the groin region, and there are some other signs like anorexia, like weight changes, like mood changes, or in this care patient we are also having bone pains and fractures. So please look for the cause. There must be some cause that is hiding within the body. You have to look for it. And I've already told you, for looking of it, we have many diagnostic tools like MRIs, we have CT scans, we have ultrasounds, we have tumor markers, which are going to indicate you people that there is something. If you find some lump, if you are going to find some tumorous thing, you can do its fine needle aspiration cytology, you can do the biopsy, and you can on this biopsy you can do the immune markers and the genetic profiling, so you are able to diagnose this. So do not miss it, do not take it very lightly. I am going to give you another example of these paraneoplastic syndromes in the lung, and you can see that how the picture is so much confusing in sometimes. Basically, my dear students, in lungs there are two types of the carcinomas: small cell carcinomas and the non-small cell carcinomas. Basically, your small cell carcinomas are going to present with the paraneoplastic syndrome that we have just discussed, syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, which is going to cause the hyponatremia, and we have told you about the hypertension. Then there is ectopic ACTH, which is going to cause the Cushing syndrome. Then we have Eaton-Lambert syndrome. Because of the increase in the repetition and increase in the reflexes, there will be the increased repetition, and the power is going to be increased with the repetitive movements. Then we have carcinoid syndrome because of the secretion of serotonin and the bradykinin, and patient is going to present with the flushing and the diarrhea. Then we have superior vena cava syndrome because of the obstruction in the regions where it is going to compress the superior vena cava, and it is going to cause the dyspnea, increased jugular venous pressure, and the face swelling. While if we are going to talk about non-small cell carcinomas of the lung, the major categories are the squamous cell carcinoma. The squamous cell carcinomas can present with the hypercalcemia. I've just told you that there is a release of parathormone-like substances. This patient can present with the Horner syndrome because of the compression of the sympathetic nerve. There is a ptosis, there are meiosis, there is anhidrosis, and then there are Pancoeur tumor, which are going to cause the pains in the shoulder and the hand areas and in the ulnar region. Then our second category in small cell carcinomas are the adenocarcinoma, and they are going to present you with hypertrophic osteoarthropathy, which is going to manifest like pains in the hands and the joints, and some abnormal location abnormalities can be seen in the hands. Then we have large cell carcinomas of the lung in the small cell variety, and this patient is going to present with you with gynecomastia and superior vena cava syndrome. So here you can see what a diverse picture. Actually, everyone is going to tell you that this carcinoma is lying within the body and it's very difficult. But my dear students, keep your eyes open, keep your brain's eyes open. There are always some signs and symptoms that your patient is showing. Whenever you are going to see your patient, see it with your brain, see it with your heart, and try to see for these types of things. That why this patient is coming to you again and again, there must be something that is going to disturbing him. My dear students, thank you very much for your patient listening. I hope you have enjoyed the lecture, and inshallah in our next lecture we are going to do the whole of the molecular carcinogenesis in detail. And tomorrow we are going to have two lectures, and we are going to finish the molecular carcinogenesis. Thank you again.